Welcome to the very first Office of the Public Guardian podcast. My name is Laura and I work in the communications team. Thank you for choosing to listen. I'm here today with Samantha, Vicky and Abdul, if you want to introduce yourselves.
Okay, I will go fast. Name's Abdul. I'm an executive case manager supervising deputies, court-appointed deputies.
So I'm Samantha. I work here in the contact centre. So I deal with a variety of different calls every day, covering both powers of attorney and deputyship. I'm one of the people that are constantly going up to Vicky for questions and they're always there to answer them delightfully. I've been here since January and I love working here.
I'm Vicky. I work on the duty manager desk, so I help people in the contact centre answer calls and any queries, and I'm also trained in other areas as well, so I'm safeguarding trained.
Great, we hope that you find this podcast informative and entertaining and that you get to take something away with you. So my first question to you guys is, how would you describe the Office of Public Guardian or OPG to like a friend or a family member?
We're here to help support people make decisions and get them to have the right to choose. So where people lack mental capacity, we're here to support those who act on their behalf to make sure that they're making good decisions. We look after vulnerable adults and ensure that if there isn't a power of attorney in place, that the Court of Protection can put something else in place for them.
So how I describe it is we're kind of there to help everybody with what they're doing. So we go from beginning to probably end. So we help them create it from the beginning, how to do it, what to do, what to put in it. And then we'll help them with when they need to act, because they always ring back and want to know how to do that. We will help them with any safeguarding, so protecting vulnerable people. And then obviously you've got the people that are going to do it and it's a bit too late, so we need to explain what they have to do, not put something in place.
And when you say it, you're referring to last and powers of attorney.
Yes.
So doing days, all right? Just to clarify that it is last and powers of attorney. What exactly is a lasting power of attorney?
So it's a document that allows someone that you trust to have access to your finances and to make financial decisions for you. And when you've lost mental capacity, to make sure that your bills are being paid, whether you're in a care home, you're staying at home, or you've got a carer.
Health and welfare.
Lasting power of attorney, which only comes into place when you lose mental capacity, and that is so that someone, again, you trust can make decisions about how you are cared for by your carers. Basically, make sure that you still get your hair cut if you had your hair cut every 4 weeks. Make sure that you're still having your beauty treatments that you had beforehand, but also keeping your diet that you wanted, and also making some tough decisions when you have to go into hospital.
And it's there for everybody. It's not just, you know, a common misconception is that it's there for the older generation, but a lasting power of attorney is something that everybody should and could do at any age, because it is there to protect you and for the what-if scenarios that often get overlooked until it's too late.
Yeah, it's one of those things that people say, oh, I don't need one, you know, I'm 22, I'm having a good time, but actually you could get hit by a bus tomorrow.
Yeah, and then you'll appreciate having one of these in place, so someone you trust can help you rather than leaving it to somebody that you've not chosen.
Yeah, which will happen if you go to the Court Protection.
Yes.
Do you want to tell me more about like the process of going to Court Protection? How we work with deputies?
Yes, I think the figures are quite high, numbers of deputies we have on our registers, definitely more than 55,000. Fortunately for people who, for one reason or another, end up losing their mental capacity, either because of mental health issues, diseases such as dementia, Alzheimer's, brain injury, accidents and things like that, and at the same time they do not have a lasting power of attorney in place, the only way the next of kin can assume responsibility or have an official authority or permission to manage such a person's finances is by applying to the Court of Protection for what we call a deputyship order. The deputyship order application itself can take anything between 3 months and 6 months for it to be approved. In most cases, it tends to be relatives who find themselves with such an unfortunate burden I think sometimes people do wrongfully tend to assume that if you are a spouse or a child of a victim of such unfortunate circumstances, by default, they may have a legal right to represent that person's interest. But the truth is, that is not true. One definitely would have to submit an application to the Court of Protection and ask for its authorization to represent that person's interest. Deputyship in itself comes in two forms. There's one for property and financial affairs, which simply allows one to exercise control and authority over the victim's, for want of a better description, over the victim's financial affairs. So bank accounts, receiving income, spending on behalf of that person, whether it's care fees, personal needs, rent, and things like that. The other type of deputyship, which is rarely given, is for health and welfare. Now, deputyship in our registers mean they have to be accountable, and that is commonly stated in the order and under the Mental Capacity Act 2005, where they are required to submit annual reports. The annual reports will reflect things like key decisions made on behalf of that person and how the finances are managed. So once a year, a deputy would be required to submit the accounts which one manages, bank accounts, for example, how much money has been received, how much money has gone out during the reporting year. And then we will look into that report, and if we detect any issues of concern, we will address that with the deputy, and we will also provide support to the deputies. So if they're struggling with completing the reports, we will offer the necessary support. OPG also provides visits, direct visits to the client, sometimes referred to as the patient. We also send visits to the deputy, where again, in most cases, those visits would be to ascertain that the person being represented, their interests are taken care of as expected. Sometimes it's about giving support to the deputies on how they're managing the affairs of the client, and things like that. So there's a good package.
Cool. So you've mentioned mental capacity in terms of a lasting power of attorney sort of comes in when you lose mental capacity. But how would you describe what is mental capacity and what's the foundation of where we are?
Mental capacity is a very great area to say that someone lacks it and someone has it. Because, and I am very much a person of this, you can make decisions that other people don't think are wise. So just because you make an unwise decision doesn't mean that you lack capacity, which a lot of people say. The Mental Capacity Act's there to protect people from being taken advantage of. It's there to protect everybody and not just have people say you lack capacity. It's there to protect you to make sure that they prove that you lack that capacity, but also to have them like interact with you. So if you did lose capacity, they should always make sure that they're checking that, you know, what you want and how you want it. Would be the cup of tea syndrome. Everybody knows how they like their cup of tea. Yeah. So if you lack mental capacity, you don't just automatically give someone a cup of tea. You always go, do you want a cup of tea? Do you want it with milk? Do you want sugar? And you let that person answer. You never just assume. That's what
right,
capacity
is. That's a good a little analogy to sort of put it into context. Yeah. Like the cup of tea, I was like, okay.
Wouldn't know where you were going with that one.
Yeah, it was like a cup of tea thing. I'm like, okay.
Well, that's how someone described it to me. I always double check. I don't just automatically do it.
Part of the principles as well for the Mental Capacity Act, and that's one of them there, is that you have to involve them with decision making. You can't just make it without them knowing. You can't just assume things. You have to still talk to them, even if you know that they don't necessarily understand what you're talking about. You still need to involve them in all decisions, so they can just be aware of what's happening, and it may help them as well.
Cool. So you said that was one of the principles. Are there other principles?
So unwise decisions. So if someone makes an unwise decision, you can't assume that they lack mental capacity. But I haven't done this in ages. So
I'm waiting. I'm waiting.
Do you know what? I wrote them all down, and I used to know them off by heart. So it's, you have to, I can't remember how they're described, but you should always check, like communicate with someone about a decision, and you should go try all means that you can. So if they can't talk, you should maybe hold up a picture and they can do that, and now I can't remember the other three.
So you always have to assume that a person has mental capacity, unless it's proven otherwise. That is a key one. No, I have a mental capacity.
I do that because I'm safeguarding officer. And the second, that's what I do.
The second key one, which Vicky should know, is everything has to be done in the best interest of the
owner. Again, I use that a lot. Safeguarding.
So if someone is lacking capacity, then you have to think what would be in their best interest. So if they've always been vegetarian, for example, and they've suddenly lost mental capacity, it wouldn't be in their best interest to start giving them sausage and bacon, because that's something that they've never usually done, and it's obviously not what they wish to continue. So it'd be in their best interest to follow the vegetarian lifestyle still. The fifth one, our least restrictive way.
Oh yeah, that's it.
So before doing anything for someone or making a decision on them, consider whether you could achieve the same outcome in a less restrictive way. So an example I had was, if somebody has a disability and they can often injure themselves when they go outside, one way of maintaining that would be to never let them go outside. But obviously that is quite restrictive, and that wouldn't be in their best interest to never let them go outdoors. So the least restrictive option would be potentially getting them a helmet or some protective gear, so when they do go out in public, they're not going to be a danger to themselves, and they've got that protection there, but they're still getting to go outside and do their daily activities that they've always done.
Okay, so we've you've mentioned safeguarding quite a bit. Do you want to tell me more about what safeguarding is and what it involves?
So Vicky is one of our safeguarding officers in the contact centre, so I will let Vicky go with this one.
Yeah, so with lasting powers of attorney and enduring powers of attorney, we have to safeguard the donor. And what a lot of people find shocking is our jurisdiction is very limited. So if the donor has capacity, they must invite us to investigate into their attorney. So if their attorney is not acting in their best interest, we can then investigate. If the donor lacks mental capacity and someone's raising concerns that the attorney is not acting in the donor's best interest, then we will investigate. But we also need evidence. It can't be just, oh, well, I don't think they're acting correctly. It's got to be, they've kind of bought brand new Mercedes, you know, gone on like 5 holidays a year, which normally they never used to do. You know, it's got to be something that shows that they're basically abusing their power and trust over the donor.
So safeguarding is there to help protect the vulnerable adults, because if they've sadly lost capacity, which is when Vicky said our jurisdiction steps in, then we're there to protect them. So they're not on their own, and it's not just because they've chosen someone to act on their behalf doesn't mean that necessarily they will always do the right thing by the donor.
Yeah.
So we're here to ensure that anything they do make decisions on, for example, selling a house, if it's done incorrectly, we're here to help protect the donor through everything. And that can be with health and welfare as well. So it's a number of things. And the deputyship team upstairs as well, who do with court orders, they also have their safeguarding processes where they will investigate any deputies that has been acting not in the best interest of the donor.
Okay, so if you get a safeguarding concern about someone you investigate, and it turns out that, you know, the person who has attorney has been buying Mercedes and going on 5 holidays a year, then what happens then? What happens with the attorney?
With investigations, they kind of have to build up a case. So they will talk to all attorneys involved. So if you've got 2 attorneys and it's just the one, they will still contact the other one and get their side of it. They gather all the evidence and kind of work out what's been happening, where the money's been spent, and they give the attorney the opportunity to explain why they've spent this money. Sometimes they can try and resolve it and, you know, obviously guide that person and say, look, you know, this is what you've done this, you've admitted it, but you shouldn't be doing that, this is how you do it. Extreme cases is that we will take the person to the court protection and have them removed. If it need be that it's only one attorney, they get removed, and if that donor's lost mental capacity, then we might have to put a deputyship in place for them, because someone needs to look after the money and make sure the person's looked after as well. That's the extreme version of the process, is them removing it. We do try and teach the attorney how to act as an attorney.
Okay, so if they've just been thinking, oh, grandma usually gives our grandkids like £150 for birthdays and Christmas or whatever, we'll just keep doing that. And then someone might raise the question, like, oh, where's this money going from the bank? Then you might just say,
things like that is fine. So if grandma always gave 150 for birthdays, that's okay. Keep on doing that because you have the past to show that they always gave that amount to for Christmas and birthdays. However, you have to take into account their estate. So as their estate goes down, maybe the level of money that you're giving away should kind of change. So you need to think about it. But that would come under gifting. So okay. That necessarily wouldn't be safeguarding. It would be more if they went from giving £150 on birthdays to £1,000 and obviously depleting the funds a lot quicker.
So again, it comes back to the principle of acting in their best interest. Because if it was a grandma, they would want to continue to give presents to family members on birthdays, Christmases. So that would still be in their best interest for the attorney to carry on doing that. Is as Vicky said, if they started going outside of their previous history, something that grandma's never done before, then that's when we would begin questioning whether or not that's in the best interest of the donor.
Do we have like some kind of strategy around looking after people? A thing that we kind of base everything on, or just like as and when?
So there is a 5-step process. So step one would be the complaint. So when we receive an initial complaint or concern, and we have to make a decision on whether or not to accept this as an investigation. And that all depends on our jurisdiction, whether or not we can. Step two would be to investigate. So we have a dedicated team who have had professional training, and they will carry out a plan with a senior investigator as well to make sure that everything that we do is accurate and error-free, and again, in the best interests of the donor. Step three would be to collaborate. So as Vicky said before, depending on the nature of the concern, we would be able to discuss with the relevant people. So perhaps that would be with social services. In worst case scenarios, maybe the police would need to be involved.
As well as if we can't investigate and we know there's something going on, we tend to see if we can pass it over to someone that could investigate as well. Karen.
So step four would be to do the report. So all the investigators must conclude their findings in a report that would then be passed on to the public guardian alongside what they would recommend. But the public guardian, as part of their duty, they reserve the right to approve, reject or amend the recommendations. So it'll all depend on what the public guardian says at the time and what they feel is the necessary action to help safeguard this adult. And then you've got two steps five. One would be to apply. So where we would need to remove an attorney or a deputy, we would have to apply to the Court of Protection, as Vicky said before, to allow that to happen. Or another step five would be to implement the decisions. So that's where the Court of Protection would have recommended something to us, so such as the attorney would need to repay the loan or repay the finances that they had taken. That would then be implemented by us at Office of the Public Guardian. So it all depends on what the Court
of Protection. All right, so do we get like a lot of investigations, I guess?
So we don't often get to see the stats in the contact centre, but the statistics currently stand, as far as we are aware, at 0.16% for concerns raised around a deputy or attorney. And then just 0.06% of those cases have progressed into an investigation. So to put it in actual numbers, if we carried out 1,897 investigations in 2017-18, only 459 of those cases resulted in an application to the court, mostly just to seek advice.
Okay, so that's not really a lot to say we've got 3.5 million registered.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, often it's just because they're not too sure on how best to act as an attorney or a deputy. So a lot of the times with the safeguarding concerns, it's something that can be dealt with and managed without going to the Court of Protection, just between ourselves here in the contact centre and investigators, just really advising attorneys on what they can and can't do. And we're here to support not just the donor, but also attorneys if they need to.
Yes, by the time you kind of go into the Court of Protection and deputyships, you've already lost capacity, or the person you're there for has. So it's already a bit of a stressful time. The last thing you want to do is spend it in a court trying to get the right to look after someone.
Absolutely.
So we've also mentioned very briefly, in sort of in passing, enduring powers of attorney. What's the difference between lasting powers of attorney and enduring powers of attorney?
Well, enduring powers of attorney was before lasting powers of attorney. And they stopped in about 2007. It only covers finance and property. It doesn't cover anything health and welfare. And you can use it unregistered, but you need to have the donor's consent and the donor needs to have mental capacity. Once the donor has lost or is losing mental capacity, then you need to get it registered with the Office of the Public Guardian so that you can start using it properly as an attorney. We only have jurisdiction over an enduring power of attorney when it's registered with us. So if an attorney is using it beforehand with the donor's consent, we don't have any jurisdiction over that. We're not involved in that. That's between the donor and the attorney.
Right, okay.
Where a lasting power of attorney, you can create it and leave it unregistered, but the attorney can't use it. They can only use it once it's been registered. And with your lasting power of attorney, you can decide when it can come in. So it can either come in straight away with your consent or when you lack mental capacity, which is a bit similar to the enduring power of attorney, but different in the terms of how you use it, sort of thing.
I think the key difference will be what you said about you can register a lasting power of attorney as soon as you've completed it. So then in the event that you sadly lose mental capacity, the attorney doesn't have to wait for the document to be registered, which can be a few weeks to several months if there was any issues with it. And so I think that's the key difference. Is a lasting power of attorney, you can register straight away, so then you can keep that document safe. So the attorneys know that if and when they ever need to use it, it's already all done and ready to go.
Okay, great. So can you still register enduring powers of attorney? Because you said they kind of stopped in 2007.
Yeah, you can still register them. You just can't create one anymore. Still register it. The only thing is because we don't know how many was created, so we don't actually know have a figure of how many is out there. And obviously, because you don't register it straight away, there's a lot out there that might be invalid and not being able to be used because they weren't signed correctly or they didn't tick anything or cross anything out on the documents, which might have an effect on, you know, on the person because they believe they've got this legal document that they can use and it could be invalid. So, yeah.
Thank you for listening so far. As a bit of a roundup of what we've just listened to, or what you've just listened to, we've gone into some facts and figures on how many LPAs are processed each year and the deputyships we supervise. We've gone into how an LPA is processed and when we get involved in investigations. We've also discussed the processes of investigations and the different steps we go through and how rare it is that actually how many investigations we take to court, we get involved in, and how many actually result in any sort of action being taken apart from some advice. And we've covered all this quite briefly in the hopes that you'll understand a little better the role that OPG plays. And if you want to know more, you can find additional podcasts online on our YouTube channel. Right, I would like to say a massive thank you to my wonderful guests today. You have been great and volunteering your time to discuss these things with me. I hope you found it useful and that you tune in to our next podcast. If you'd like to keep up to date on what's happening with the Office of the Public Guardian, then feel free to get in touch. You can go online at www.gov.uk/OPG, or you can follow us on Twitter at @OPGGovUK. Or if you have any queries, email us at customerrelations@publicguardian.gov.uk, or call us on 0300 456 0300, and you might even speak to Samantha herself.